Hi, I'm Tom Field, Vice President of Editorial with Information Security Media Group. I'm talking about online identity today. I'm talking with Tom Smedinghoff. He's a partner with a law firm of Edwards Wildman Palmer LLP. Tom, thanks so much for joining me today.
Thanks for having me.
Just as an introduction to our audience, tell us a little bit about yourself and your practice, please.
Sure. So my practice is focused basically on electronic business activities. So I do a lot of work with data security, privacy, identity management has become a really hot topic in my world, as well as electronic transactions generally.
Now, you've been speaking at RSA about online identity, an increasingly complicated area. What are some of the legal, landmines in online identity?
Well, sure. If I could just back up a little bit, I think the first thing to recognize is that businesses are starting to get to the point where identity is becoming very complex and very expensive for them to manage on their own. So in a sense, they're looking at outsourcing identity or looking to third parties who can do the work of identity. This is sometimes referred to as federated identity management. So when businesses get into a multi-party identity arrangement, there's a lot of issues, well, first and foremost, relating to privacy, because when we talk about identity, we're talking about personal information and verifying someone's personal information, verifying their identity. So privacy is a huge issue. Another really big topic that comes up over and over again is the question of liability. If I assert someone's identity to a third party and I'm wrong and they act on that, what's my risk? What's my liability? It's turning out to be a huge question, and part of the problem is that the existing law is so ambiguous that nobody really knows what they're getting into, and so that's been, a real barrier to some of the online identity projects that have been proposed.
What do you see as some of the key risks for organizations?
Well, I think ultimately, a large part of it, it's a security risk. You need to know who you're dealing with, especially from an access control perspective, as well as from an e-commerce perspective. Who are we doing business with? Who are we letting into our servers and letting into our database? That kind of a thing. So it's a huge security risk. And identity is really a critical component of a good security program. And I would say just, I go back to the privacy and liability components of it as well.
So you've got so many different players here as you describe it. And I can see that if you're an organization that's a multinational, you've got potential regulatory and legal issues everywhere. Where do you see organizations tripping up?
Well, this is sort of one of the big questions that we're kind of focused on these days, because the way the law applies to identity transactions is really just getting going. We're really just starting to develop that area of the law. So we've got sort of three layers, and this is what I've been focused on here at RSA. So you've got the top layer is existing general law that applies to everyone for all kinds of transactions. It may or may not apply to identity transactions, and if it does, we're not always quite sure how it does. That second layer, which we're starting to see a lot of activity in, has to do with government-driven regulation of identity transactions. We're seeing more of this in Europe than we are in the U.S., and in the U.S., particularly through the NSTIC program, the National Strategy for Trusted Identities in Cyberspace, the U.S. is looking at sort of a voluntary structure for, in a sense, regulating identity transactions. But then the third layer, and probably the most important one for businesses participating in identity transactions, is what some people refer to as trust frameworks or operating rules, but it's basically the private contractual-based set of rules that are going to govern the system that basically provides identity information for online transactions.
So you brought this topic to RSA this week. What was your key message about it?
The key message, I think, is that that third layer, that privately driven approach to regulating identity is really where the emphasis needs to go, because that's where the parties have the ability to control their risk, to allocate the risk among all the different players, and to really specify the rules of the road, if you will, that'll both make identity transactions work from a pure functional point of view, as well as make them trustworthy so that we can we can rely on the information we're getting, but at the same time, not feel like we're walking into a liability or privacy landmine.
So with so many unanswered questions, how do you recommend that organizations proceed through what are pretty tricky waters?
Yeah, it is pretty tricky at this point. And you're right, there are a lot of unanswered questions. So I think you have to kind of take it slow, but it's important to focus on the rules for any particular identity system that a business is considering participating in. If they can play a role in shaping those rules, obviously that is really critical. But if they can't, if they're coming in afterwards, it's really important to understand those rules, understand how they affect the business. And this sort of gets into the cybersecurity framework kind of thing that we just saw out of NIST, and that is looking at your individual business environment. What are your risks? What are your vulnerabilities? What are your needs? And fitting that into an identity system. So for example, you have some very simple identity systems, and a good example is Facebook Connect. Facebook will provide information about individuals who want to log into a website, for example, but it's all self-asserted information. It's probably somewhat reliable, but there's no guarantees. Facebook just says, I'm going to give you what I have. But if you're doing some really significant transactions, for example, in the aerospace and defense industry, where you're dealing with very sensitive data, you need a very robust identity system when you're dealing with third parties for purposes of identifying them and making sure that only the right people get access to the right data. So there you really have to develop a really significantly robust system with both the technical controls and the legal controls.
So you talked about the idea was to be a part of making the rules here. How does somebody get a voice in this process?
Well, there's a lot happening. The NSTIC process is one venue. A lot of the other groups that are working on this also offer opportunities. There's the Open Identity Exchange, for example. There's Kantara. There's Safe Biopharma. There's the federal program. There's the what's referred to as the IDESG, the Identity Ecosystem Steering Group that comes out of the NSTIC project. All of these groups are working on a variety of approaches to identity. And for businesses that really want to have a voice in that, these are the kind of places they should be participating.
Now, how do you advise organizations to assess their vulnerabilities here? You almost have to do a risk assessment.
That's really the starting point. And again, that comes back to sort of the recently released cybersecurity framework. It's all about what do you need for your business and what are your business risks. And if you don't know that, you can't get to second base. You've really got to start with that basic risk assessment. Know what you have, know what your vulnerabilities and threats are, know what your risk points are, and then go from there.
Is there any doubt you're going to have a busy year?
I think so.
Tom, thank you for your time and insight today.
Okay, thank you.
The topic has been online identity. I've been talking with Tom Smedinghoff, partner with Edwards Wildman and Palmer LLP. For Information Security Media Group, I'm Tom Field. Thank you very much.